I put the first quiz up on Sunday. I think many of you saw that. The first time I put it up, I gave you two chances because I've found in the past that things happen. This is the CourseWorks quiz. Things happen, so you need a second chance just to get familiar with the system if you haven't already. But after, if you have more than one chance, you can't get feedback on the answers, right? So it's either one or the other. Obviously, if you got feedback after each chance, eventually you would simply get the answer by elimination. We want you to learn. So after this round, next Sunday, those questions, you'll have one time to do them, okay? But then you will get feedback. And that's the way I've done it in the past. I kind of like it that way. If you have the lecture slides in front of you, you should be able to answer all the questions without difficulty. If you're on the subway with your phone, it might be harder, because if you lose the signal in the middle of the quiz, it gets complicated. Okay, today we are talking about, do you have a question? No, feedback means when you submit your answers, it tells you whether you got them right or wrong. And right now there isn't any because you get two chances. But next week we'll have one chance, then you'll get feedback. They'll tell you, no, that's the wrong answer, or yes, it's the right answer. That's what I mean by feedback. Yes?
Does this cover the current week's material or the previous?
Previous week. So this one went up yesterday. It was last week's lecture. If there's only one lecture a week, it's just three questions. Three questions per lecture. Yes?
You can just look at the grade book and
it'll tell you the results?
Yeah, it'll tell you out of time how much you got.
For each question, it will tell you right or wrong, too? Just no, because you'd like question by question feedback, right? You know, I answered A on question one, and it should be D or something like that. That's what I mean, yeah. You don't really need more than one chance, trust me. Last year, the whole, except for the first quiz, everyone had one chance, and most people got over 90% on all the quizzes, all right? Any other questions? Okay, today I'm going to tell you about the infectious cycle. I'm going to tell you what it is, why we care, and how we study it. And this will be the basis for a lot of the things that we're going to be talking about in the rest of the course. So it's really crucial that you understand the concepts here today. The infectious cycle means what goes on in a cell when a virus approaches, attaches, and gets in and begins to replicate. Okay, and this is an example of a cell that's infected with a virus. And we're illustrating all the different steps that go on. Each of these steps, by the way, is a lecture in our course. This is the first half of the course. So this is the infectious cycle, what goes on from start to when new virions are made. Now, virologists like to divide cycles up into bits, right? We have attachment and entry. These are when the virus particles encounter a cell and bind to a receptor. The release of the genome into the cytoplasm or wherever it has to end up, depends on the virus. Translation, the synthesis of proteins, the synthesis of nucleic acids, and then assembly and release. In a cell, of course, there are no boundaries between each of these steps. It's just for us to be able to categorize them and study them independently. And in virology, there's so much specialization that any given virologist will probably be studying just a fraction of one of these steps. So this is the infectious cycle, and most of virology comprises trying to figure out what goes on in an infected cell. If you don't know that, you won't have any clue about what's going on in an infected host, an animal, or a plant, or whatever the virus is infecting. So we first start by understanding the infectious cycle. All right, so that's all that we mean by the infectious cycle, the whole scheme of virus replication. Is this my voice becoming a Cylon again like it was last time? Is it okay? Just a little bit. You guys know what a Cylon is, right? No? Okay. All right. Before we go into this infectious cycle, we need to be on the same page with some definitions, because these words here that are bolded in the English language can mean different things. It's one of the things about English, right? One word can mean many things. But in science, that's really bad if one word means different things. So I want to tell you my definitions for these words. I have to tell you that having written or co-authored a textbook, you have to make sure that when you use a word 300 times throughout the textbook, it means the same thing. So we're very careful about this. So these are definitions that have to do with the infectious cycle. The first is a susceptible cell. What that means, if I say my cells are susceptible to influenza virus, that means that they have a receptor that the virus can bind to and initiate infection. That's all susceptible means. It doesn't mean anything beyond the receptor point. It's very important to remember that. It doesn't mean that once the virus gets in that it can actually replicate and make more viruses. Susceptible. Now, you probably have used susceptible in different ways. You talk about being susceptible to infection, but that's not the same thing. Susceptible in our jargon means having a receptor for the particular virus that you're talking about. A resistant cell has no receptor. And that's all that resistance means. It doesn't have any implications for beyond the receptor stage. A permissive cell can replicate the virus. In other words, once the virus gets in, the virus can multiply its nucleic acid, it can assemble new virions and leave the cell. That's what permissive means. It has no implications for whether there's a receptor on the cell surface. It only means that once the nucleic acid is inside the cell, it can begin to replicate and make new virions. And a cell that's not permissive would be a non-permissive cell, whereas resistant has to do with the receptor. So these are very fine definitions here, but they're important because that's how we use these phrases. And if I ask you a question using one of these words, it's going to be meaning having a very precise meaning. Finally, a susceptible and permissive cell is the only cell that a virus can bind to, get in, and replicate in. Okay, susceptible and permissive. You need both of them. Susceptible at the receptor level and permissive beyond the receptor. One way to look at this experimentally is if you take a virus particle and you extract the nucleic acid and just put the nucleic acid into the cell, that bypasses the receptor stage. And with that kind of an experiment, you can find out whether, in fact, the cell is permissive or not without worrying about the receptor. We'll talk about that next time in more detail. Now, at the beginning of virology, the science of virology, the end of the 1800s, the beginning of the 1900s, the only way that people could grow viruses was in an animal or a plant host. It wasn't possible to have cultured cells. So they were grown in a variety of hosts, some of which are shown here. And some of these are still used today to propagate viruses. And not just studying how the virus infects these animals and cause disease, but actually making stocks of virus. Now, a stock of virus is simply a tube containing the virus solution. If you come to my lab, I'll open my freezer and you'll see lots and lots of tiny tubes full of viruses. Those are stocks of viruses. We make those in cell culture nowadays, and we'll talk about how that's done. But back in the old days, there were no cell cultures for a variety of reasons, and you had to grow viruses in animals. Okay, now that changed, and we'll talk about that, but it was very difficult. And when you pass viruses from animal to animal, you select for changes. So in the very beginning of the 1900s, there weren't even freezers, so you couldn't grow your virus in a dog and put it in the freezer till you needed to do an experiment. You had to inoculate a dog, and when the dog died, you made extracts of whatever tissues the virus is replicating in, and then you inoculate another dog, and then you go again for another couple of weeks. And that really imposes selection on viruses. Fortunately, we do have freezers now. One of the most convenient animals from the very beginning of virology was the embryonated egg, which is shown in a cross section here. And that's, of course, because it's a chicken egg, and it typically 10 to 12 days incubation gives you an embryo of about this size. And this can be inoculated with a variety of different viruses, and they will grow in different parts of the egg. And you can see here different routes of inoculation into the various membranes, chorioallantoic, amniotic, even yolk sac and allantoic. And then here you can see some of the viruses that will grow in them. Nowadays, these aren't used very much except to propagate influenza viruses. In fact, one of the influenza virus vaccines is propagated in embryonated chicken eggs. It's done so by inoculating the virus into the allantoic cavity. That's this big one here that bathes the embryo. And you get about 6 mL per egg. And that makes one batch of vaccine. So the next time you get a flu shot, if you get the egg-grown shot, you can just think that's one egg's worth of virus going into your arm. And this is why if you have allergies to eggs or feathers, you probably should stay away from the influenza vaccines. This is just a picture showing you how the vaccines are made. The companies that make influenza vaccines have highly automated processes for inoculating the eggs. There are machines that drill little holes in the eggs. They put in just the right amount of virus. They put them on a rack. They go into an incubator. This is the inoculation part here. They're incubated for X number of days. And then another machine puts a hole in the egg and takes out the virus for purification. So many, many millions of eggs, over 140 million eggs every year in the US go to making flu vaccine. Now, the real breakthrough in virology came in the 1940s when John Enders here, who was here on the cover of Time magazine, showed that it was possible to grow poliovirus in cell cultures derived from human embryonic tissues. Now, this had never been done before. People had a lot of trouble growing viruses in cell cultures of any kind. And by a cell culture, we mean taking some sort of tissue and dispersing it and putting it on a solid layer. Back then it was glass, but now we use plastic. The cells will grow, and then you can infect them with your virus. So John Enders was the first to show that an animal virus will do that. And he and two of his colleagues got the Nobel Prize for that in 1954. At least one of his two collaborators, I think, was a medical student who was working in his laboratory. And when Enders was told he got the Nobel Prize, he said, "Oh, you have to include these two guys, too, because they did all the work," which is really nice. So this started the era of virology and cell culture. This allowed the synthesis or the manufacture of a polio vaccine by 1955. So nowadays we have all sorts of cell cultures that we use to propagate our viruses. Here on the upper left is a primary human cell line. So you take a tissue, you disperse it into single cells, then you put it on a plastic monolayer, and it will grow. And human foreskin fibroblast is a common line because you can get lots of foreskin. You just have to visit a hospital. And you make primary foreskin fibroblasts, and you can grow them for X number of doublings before they will die. So primary cells do not live forever. They may be divide 20 or 30 times, and then they die. But for some experiments, you want a primary line, because what happens to cells when they leave the primary stage is not often good for virology. Here in the middle is an example of a mouse fibroblast cell line. It's called 3T3. So these were originally made from a mouse tissue and put in culture as primary cells. But then after so many divisions, some cells spontaneously become continuous. They transform, and we'll talk about that actually in a lecture later on. And now these cells will grow forever. And you can grow them from day to day, week, week, month to month. You keep stocks in your freezer, but you can basically grow them forever and do your experiments in them. And on the right is a human equivalent. This is an epithelial cell line, the very famous HeLa cell line, which is used for many different viral experiments. So these two are continuous cell lines. This is a primary. These continuous cell lines tend to have abnormal chromosomal makeups. They have duplications and deletions and so forth because they've been growing for many years. They're transformed. What that means, we'll talk about later. But the transformation process is accompanied by a lot of mutation. So these are not normal. They're not normal cells. For the most part, they're perfectly fine to do certain kinds of experiments. But if you want a non-transformed cell, you go to a primary cell, or you can use what are called diploid cell strains. There are a couple of these, such as the WI38, which is a human embryonic lung cell line. These maintain the diploid number of chromosomes. They are not transformed, but they will live longer than a primary cell line. They won't live forever. They're not immortal, but they will live a long time. So for some experiments, it's useful. Now, the HeLa cells are a very famous cell line. There was a book written a couple of years ago which became a phenomenal bestseller, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. How many of you have read this? Yeah. So this is the story of HeLa cells, which were taken from a tumor from Henrietta in 1951. And she eventually died, and the cells, a biopsy of her cells, were brought into a lab at Johns Hopkins. And they eventually became the HeLa cell line, the first immortal human cell line that grew forever and ever. We grow them in our lab still this day. But of course, she didn't know about it because she had died. It was a cervical tumor that the cells were derived from. But her family wasn't told either, and they found out 20 or 30 years later. And this describes the trauma that the family went through. This author really insinuated herself with the family and got a really interesting story. So we grow lots of cells in our lab to grow viruses. Nowadays, we use plastic dishes of all different sorts. And these, in each of these dishes, the cells are growing as a monolayer. They're bathed in medium, which provides nutrients and buffer for the cells. And this is all contained in an incubator that has 5% CO2 to keep the pH as neutral as possible. If you need a lot of cells, you can grow them in what's called a spinner culture. And here you have about a liter of medium. And you can see there's a magnetic bar in there. And this is sitting on a magnetic stir plate, so it's constantly spinning. And these grow to very high densities. These are, in fact, HeLa cells that we're growing in our laboratory to use for our viral studies. So if you need lots and lots of cells, a spinner is great. But spinners don't work for every cell line. For reasons that are not clear, they only work for some of them. So let's do a Socrative now. Go to that m.socrative.com. And the room, of course, is virus. Okay. A blank and blank cell is the only cell that can tape up a virus particle and replicate it. Okay, most people have got susceptible and permissive. That's the answer. Susceptible means it has a receptor for the virus. Permissive means the cells can take up the virus and replicate it and make more of this. And none of these others are the right combination. It's always susceptible and permissive. Everyone pretty much got that, except a few people got primary and permissive. A primary refers to cells that are made from a tissue, which may or may not be susceptible. We don't know. But permissive is part of it, but it's not the whole thing. Okay? Okay. Now, when you grow viruses in cells, and I've just told you all kinds of cells that we can use to grow viruses. How do you know the virus is growing when you add virus to your HeLa cells or whatever? How do you know they're growing? So one way, a very easy way, is by what the virus does physically to the cells, and it's called cytopathic effect. The virus induces changes in the cells during replication that you can see in a light microscope. You can just put these cells on a scope. Here is just a light microscope image of HeLa cells, and you can see them quite well. And then these have been infected with poliovirus. And then 4, 8, and 12 hours after infection, I think you can see the progressive change in the cells. They're beginning to round up, and eventually they detach from the plastic monolayer that they're grown on, and then many of them will break beyond that. So this is one kind of cytopathic effect. It's very obvious, so you can tell if you have virus in your specimen, for example. There are many different kinds of cytopathic effects. This is just one of them. This is called cell rounding and detachment from the monolayer and lysis. Another kind of cytopath effect is called formation of syncytia. A syncytium, which is the singular, this is plural, is nothing more than a cell which is resulted from the fusion of multiple cells. So we start out with single cells in a culture. We infect them with virus, and the virus induces them to fuse by mechanisms we'll talk about later. And here you see these two cells have fused. Now there's two nuclei in a single cell, and then more of them fuse. So you have large cells with multiple nuclei. That's called a syncytium. And this is a photograph of the real thing here. On the bottom, you can see some individual cells. These are kind of rounded up. And here is a syncytium. It's attached to the monolayer. You can see it's flat. And you can see multiple nuclei within it. So only certain kinds of viruses do this. It's, in a way, diagnostic for the kind of virus. For example, poliovirus never forms syncytium, but measles virus and related viruses do. All right, so that's just two examples of cytopathic effects. These are visible ways of telling if a virus is infecting your cells. And this is a list of many others. Here on the right are the different viruses. And you'll get to know these viruses better as we proceed in this course, but each of these is a different kind of virus. And you can see different morphological alterations in here, syncytium formation, which I just showed you, rounding up and detachment of cultured cells. I showed you that as well. And then many other kinds of alterations, again, which you can see in the microscope. Yes? Can be either. It can be an infected cell and an uninfected cell. The infected cell is displaying a new protein, a viral protein on its surface, which is fusogenic, and that will fuse with any neighboring cell. All right, so these are morphological alterations. Again, you can see these in a light microscope. Here are some kinds of cytopathic effects. They're called inclusion bodies. That is, if you look at the cell, you begin to see dark spots within the cytoplasm or the nucleus. And they're very characteristic of the particular virus. So for example, rabies virus causes what are called Negri bodies. And these are virions. These are clumps of virions in the cytoplasm. So there's so many virions that you can actually see them. Because of course, a single virus you'd not be able to see by light microscope unless it was one of those giant viruses. And when people are suspected to have rabies, you can sometimes make a preliminary diagnosis based on the presence of Negri bodies. Pox viruses make what are called Guarnieri bodies. These are factories, again, places where virions are assembling in the cytoplasm. So different sorts of cytopathic effects. So that's the first level of understanding that our cells are infected. The second is how many viruses is in our sample? And when we grow the sample in a cell, how many viruses are being made? And we have two ways of measuring this. We have infectivity measurements, and we have physical measurements of either the particles or the components. And these are two very different kinds of assay. I'm going to go through some of them with you. Infectivity will actually tell you how many infectious viruses are in a sample, whether that's a nasal wash that I've taken from someone who we think has influenza, or if it's a supernatant from a cell in our laboratory that we've infected with a virus. Either way, we can measure how many infectious viruses are present. And then the physical is simply counting particles or components. It doesn't tell you about infectivity. The first measurement of infectivity, and the best, in my view, is the plaque assay. And this was initially developed in the 1930s by virologists who were studying bacteriophages. These, of course, are viruses that infect bacteria. And this is a plaque. This is a petri dish. It has an agar layer in it. And on top of the agar, there is a lawn of bacteria. So bacteria are the hosts for these viruses. And when the lawn was initially put down on the agar, it had been mixed with a certain number of virus particles or a dilution of a virus stock. And after incubation, you can see these holes in the bacterial lawn. And these are plaques. And these are where a single virus particle, an infectious particle, has infected a bacterium and initiated a cycle of infection. So the plaque assay initially used to study bacteriophages. Eventually, the animal virologists picked up on it. And in particular, Renato Dubecco here in 1952. He said, we can do this for animal viruses. So he took the plaque assay of bacteriophages and worked it out for a poliovirus and a few other viruses. So this was the photograph from his 1952 papers. It's not a great plaque assay. I'll show you a really good one in a moment. But that was a long time ago. He got the Nobel Prize in 1975 for this and many other developments. And here's his original paper. He was at Caltech. In a plaque assay, you have a stock of virus, and that's right here. So again, that virus stock is could be something in my freezer, or it could be a wash, or it could be a sample of cerebrospinal fluid. You want to know if there's some virus in it. You then make dilutions in some sort of buffer, and you make, in this example, we're showing tenfold serial dilutions. You take 0.1 ml and put it into 0.9 ml. That's a tenfold dilution. And you keep doing it on and on. You don't do it forever, but you have a sense of how well your virus can grow. There's usually a maximum, so you don't have to go out too far. And then you take a small amount of each of these dilutions. In this case, we're showing 0.1 ml, and you add it to a monolayer of cells. So we take some cells that we have growing in our incubator, we remove the medium, and we add a very small volume of inoculum, we call it, and these are basically dilutions of the virus. We use a small volume so that we have rapid attachment of the virus particles to cells. If you did this in 5 mLs, it would be too dilute and the virions would never attach. So you add the viruses, you let them attach to the cells for a half hour to an hour, and then you cover them with an agar overlay. So normally we grow cells in liquid, but for a plaque assay, you put an agar overlay. Now what that means is it's semi-solid. All right, it's not a liquid. If you pick it up, it will remain solid. And that allows plaques to form. And then you would stain them. You remove the agar overlay. You can stain the cells. And wherever the cells have been killed by virus infection, you see a little hole or a plaque. And then you can count them. And based on the number of plaques and the dilution factor, you can calculate the titer of this virus is 1.7 times 10 to the 8th PFU per mil. And you can see that there are 17 plaques here, and this is the 10 to the minus 6 dilution, and then there's another tenfold dilution factor from adding only 0.1 mLs, and that's how you get 1.7 times 10 to the 8th. So that's the plaque assay. Here's some photographs of viral plaques up close. So on the lower left is a single plaque. All right, we've gone close in the magnification. These are all normal cells around it. And in the middle, you can see the cells are rounded up and detached. So when you remove the agar overlay, all these cells go away, and that gives you the hole in the monolayer. On the right is a different kind of plaque. This is made with a herpes virus that has a beta-lactamase gene in it, and it makes a blue color. So instead of seeing cytopathic effects, you see the blue color formed by the virus multiplying. And on a larger view, you can actually count plaques in a similar way. Now, the way a plaque forms, when you add your virus to the monolayer, say initially one cell is infected. That's the red cell shown at the top. And we're making dilution, so we will get single cells infected. When that cell produces virus, and we're going to use a cell line, of course, that's susceptible and permissive, so we go through the whole infectious cycle. When that cell makes virus, the viruses will spread to the neighboring cells and infect them. That's why we use an agar overlay to restrict the spread of the virus. If we had a liquid overlay on top of these cells, whenever a cell made viruses, those viruses would diffuse throughout the culture and infect every cell. You'd never see plaques. The plaque gets bigger and bigger until you can see it by the naked eye. So that's how a plaque develops. Now, this is a movie of the development of a plaque. This is time-lapse photography. What was done here was to do a plaque assay, and then at the very early stages, identify where a plaque was growing. You can see the very earliest frame. There are a few dead cells in the middle. And they put a camera on it, and it took, you know, an exposure every 15 minutes or so. And this is 12, 13, 14, 15 hours total, so it's time-lapse. And you can see how the infected cells spread out, like sort of like dropping a stone in a pond, right? The initial infected cells here, then the virus is released and spreads until the plaque gets bigger and bigger. And of course, by 15 hours, you could then stain this monolayer and see a hole. Now remember, we've looked in on one single plaque on this monolayer. This plate has lots and lots of different plaques. So this movie, I think, really illustrates very nicely what a plaque assay is. So we do a lot of plaque assays in our lab. And one of my postdocs a couple of years ago did a huge experiment. She kept all the plates, and they called it the wall of polio. And it's It's still there, and when people visit my lab, I take their picture in front of it, and you can see there all kinds of people have visited and had their picture there. So if you come to visit, don't be surprised if I ask you to take your picture there. Did you have a question? So we are identifying the virus. Well, we know that virus is replicating because of the cytopathic effect, the rounding of the cells and the spread of the infection. So right now, these cells are mostly uninfected. You can see a few infected cells around the center of the plaque. That's the beginning of the plaque. And then if we run it, you can see that spreads out. So all those are cell detachment and rounding, the same things I showed you earlier in still photos. Spreading out. So that's a plaque, and that's how we know virus is there. Yeah?
What's a PFU?
A PFU is a plaque-forming unit. So when we measure virus by these assays, the unit is a plaque-forming unit because that's, in fact, what it is. We, for reasons that will become clear, we can't really call it something else. Is there another question here? Yeah?
If the virus you're using doesn't round and catch the cells,
right.
Do you have to stain for different things, like with that herpes virus?
Okay, so not all viruses will form plaques. Some viruses don't even cause rounding or detachment or lysis or don't cause any cytopathic effect. Then you have to do other things, and it gets harder. That's why we're very lucky that our virus does this, and we can do so many plaque assays. Okay, let's take another quiz here. So this is, when doing a plaque assay, what is the purpose of adding a semi-solid agar overlay on the monolayer of infected cells? All right, now here we have a little confusion. Most of you got number 5, to restrict viral diffusion after lysis of infected cells. So that's the key point. When an infected cell releases virus, if you had a liquid overlay, the viruses would spread throughout the culture, so you wouldn't be able to see plaques. An agar overlay allows the virus to stay near where it was produced in that initial cell, and that's how you get a plaque. The next most common answer was 4, to keep the cells adherent to the plate during incubation. They are adherent cells to begin with. And when you have them growing under liquid, they stay stuck on the plastic, so that's not the reason. A pH indicator, we do use medium to indicate the pH, the color of the phenol red in the medium, but that's not why we add an agar overlay. To ensure that the cells remain susceptible and permissive, that won't be changed by having an agar overlay, and it doesn't have anything to do with stabilizing virions. So this is a plaque assay that we do. It's very nice. It's a long time since 1952. Technology has changed, but this is influenza virus making a plaque. Now, a really important question is, how many viruses do you need to form a plaque? This is important because if you needed more than one, it would be very difficult to make pure stocks of viruses by just plucking one of these plaques off the plate and propagating it. So that's an important question. The way we answer it is to do a dose response curve. So we simply plot, we do a plaque assay where we make dilutions of virus. So the x-axis here is the relative virus concentration. So less concentrated to more concentrated. And then we just count the number of plaques on the y-axis. So it's a range of dilutions within a range that's countable on the plate. You know, 5, 10, 15, 20, whatever plaques. And if one virus is enough to form a plaque, the dose response curve, which is what we're doing here, we're asking the dose of virus versus the response in the number of plaques. The dose response curve will be linear. Okay, and this experiment was done, in fact, by Renato Dulbecco in the 50s when he first developed the plaque assay for animal viruses. And he said, how many viruses does it take to form a plaque? And he found that for most viruses, or at least the ones he studied, they only need one. One virus particle is enough to form a plaque. And that's because the number is proportional to the first power of the concentration of the virus inoculated. Some viruses actually have two-hit kinetics. You actually need two particles to make a plaque. There's some plant viruses where the genome is in two pieces of nucleic acid and they're packaged separately. So you need to have both of those infect a single cell. So you get two-hit kinetics with those viruses and the dose response is curved in this way. All right, so for most viruses, one virus is enough to form a plaque. And so we can use this to purify viruses. We can do a plaque assay, and then in a plaque assay you normally would take off the agar overlay and then you would stain the monolayer with a dye. So if you remember the picture I showed you, that this is called crystal violet. There are many others, but the crystal violet stains the living cells, and if there are no cells, there will be a white spot on the monolayer. If you don't do that, you leave the agar on, you can actually hold the plate up to the light and see the plaques without staining them. Then you can plunge a pipette into the plaque, remove the agar, and put it in some buffer, and now you have plaque-purified a virus. And this is used to make clonal virus stocks, and we do it three times just to make sure that there are no viruses hiding in a single plaque. So sometimes you could get two, just by chance, you could have two viruses infecting neighboring cells, and they would look like they're forming one plaque, but it's not really. So plaque purification depends on this one-hit kinetics. Now, if your virus doesn't form plaques, but it does kill cells, you can do what's called an endpoint dilution assay. Again, you make dilutions of your virus, and they're shown here from 10 to the minus, I can't even read this, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And then you inoculate, in this case, a 96-well plate. Each of these wells has a tiny monolayer of cells in it. And then you incubate them, you put a liquid overlay on top, and then you simply score for cytopathic effect. You look for virus killing the cells. And you put a plus if there's cytopathic effect, and a minus if there's none. And you do this in many replicates. Each column is a replicate of the same dilution. And then you figure out the dilution that gives you 50% cell killing. And you don't always fall on that 50% dilution. I think minus 5 here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, that's the 50% dilution. Of course, I made that so it was exactly 50%. Most of the time, you're not going to the 50% won't fall on one dilution or another, and you have to use a mathematical formula to extrapolate. But then you express the titer of the virus in TCID 50, tissue culture infectious dose 50%. All that means is it's the amount of virus, the dilution of virus, that infects half of the wells in this assay. And for here, the TCID 50 would be 10 to the fifth. It's the inverse of the dilution. All right, so for many viruses, we can't do plaque assays. This is a suitable substitute. Now you may be asking why, if the virus can kill cells, that's how we can assay a TCID 50, why doesn't it form a plaque? Well, it just so happens that some viruses are sensitive to the components of agar, and they don't form plaques. But if you just grow them under liquid, they will kill cells. Now, another issue that we need to deal with in virology is called the particle to PFU ratio. All right, physical particles to PFU. Now, the PFU is this infectivity measurement that we just described, plaque-forming unit. And when you do a plaque assay on a virus, that's the unit you report, 1 times 10 to the 7th plaque-forming units per mil. And we make a ratio of the physical to the PFU ratio, and that's what's shown here. Turns out that this is quite variable among viruses. You would think, maybe intuitively, that the particle to PFU ratio should be 1, but it's not. For some viruses, it's close to 1, like this Semleaky Forest virus. Some, it's slightly higher, 10 or so, but for others, you can see it's quite high. In other words, for poliovirus, there are between, for every infectious particle, which gives you a PFU, there are between 30 and 1,000 physical particles. That means most of the particles in a virus stock are defective. They're not giving rise to a plaque. And this is important because when you do an experiment, let's say you infect cells and you look at them in the electron microscope and you're trying to follow some aspect of infection, if you have a high particle to PFU ratio, you're never sure if the particles you're looking at in the infected cell are actually going through an infectious cycle or they're dead and they're not doing anything. So this is an important concern with certain kinds of experiments. And again, the way you measure this, you do a plaque assay, and then you do some other kind of assay which measures physical particles. You can look at them in an electron microscope, or you can measure the protein content if you know the relationship between protein content and particles. Yes?
Why do you want to create plaque assays? What's the point of creating, 50%, TCID 50%?
Why are we doing that? So a TCID, you would do a TCID 50 if you can't do a plaque assay. And the goal of both is to measure how many viruses are in your stock or in your sample. You want to know the quantity of infectious viruses. You could do a plaque assay, or if that's not possible, you do a TCID 50. Yeah?
Would the TCID 50 then be used in, or do we have a way of calculating or quantifying those that went into the lysogenic cycle?
So for these viruses, so this is, it's a little complicated. For these viruses, we're assuming we're in the lytic cycle. There are many viruses that have both a lytic and a latent cycle, but will still form a plaque. And you just have to identify the right conditions so it's always lytic for those. Right? You could do the same thing with bacteriophages, make sure they're always lytic. Yeah. So here you measure the physical number of particles, again, by some physical method, electron microscopy or protein determination, even nucleic acid. Nowadays, you could use a nucleic acid-based method. And you divide it by the PFU. That's the particle to PFU ratio. Now, why is the particle to PFU ratio so high for some viruses? Well, first of all, we do know that a single particle can initiate infection, right? It's possible that a single particle can initiate infection. We know that from the dose response curve. The linear dose response curve tells us that one particle is enough to form a plaque. But the high particle to PFU ratio tells us that it always doesn't always happen that way. Not all viruses are successful at initiating an infection. Okay, so once again, in theory, one virus can make a plaque, and we have shown that experimentally by the dose response curve, but not all viruses make it. Why? Well, we think that every preparation of virus stock, there's lots of damaged particles that block their infectivity. There may be mutations in the genomes, and we'll talk about how those may accumulate later on in the course. But maybe the most important is the last example here. The infectious cycle, which is what we're talking about today, this series of events from the start to the finish, from a virus attaching to a cell to the cell making more viruses, it's pretty complicated. And things have to happen in a certain sequence. If you skip any of the steps, the virus doesn't make it to the end. So if there are 10 or 12 or 50 steps in an infectious cycle, depending on the complexity of the virus, failure at any one step results in no virus being made. So we think that's a major reason why, in any given stock of virus, there are a lot of viruses that just don't make it. That's the particle to PFU ratio. So, again, the number of particles in a sample divided by the number of infectious particles. Some viruses, it's close to one, some bacteriophages and even some animal viruses, but it's mostly high for animal viruses, and it does complicate the study of viruses because you don't know what you're looking at. Okay, let's take another question. In the property known as particle to PFU ratio, particle can best be described as. Okay, this is where Socrative shines. You can tell when I didn't make my point clearly enough. So I know you can't see this, and I've just figured out how I'm going to show these graphs to you next time. But you can see there's a little bit of scatter in the bars. So most people got number two, a virus which may or may not be infectious. That's the right answer, because particle is a physical measurement. You're looking at a virus stuck under the electron microscope. So you don't know if it's infectious. All you know is it's a particle. Yes?
So just to get the vocabulary right, so a particle may be a virus or a virion?
No, a virion is an infectious particle.
Okay.
A virion is always infectious. Particle may or may not be infectious. So that's why number two is right. And you know, some people picked one. One of the proteins which makes up the virion, we're only talking about whole virions now, not proteins. Infectivity doesn't refer to particle. Again, particle could be either one, which is not infectious. No, it has to be both, either infectious or not. And a virion, again, is, as we said, is the infectious particle. So those are all concepts I want you to understand. Virion, particle, okay, infectious. All right. The one-step growth cycle is a way to study the infectious cycle. And this was pioneered in the 1930s with studies on bacteriophages. They would take a culture of E. coli, shown here, and adsorb phages. Adsorb means allow the viruses to bind to the cells. They would then dilute the culture. Now, you want to adsorb viruses to cells in a concentrated form. That accelerates the binding reaction. As I said before, if you do binding in too dilute a culture, the virus will never bind in the time of your experiment. So then you adsorb for a fixed amount of time, then you dilute the culture to stop binding and allow the infection to begin. And then you can sample and measure viruses. And for these kinds of studies, you can use a plaque assay and measure the amount of virus produced. So let's see what happens. Here on the left, we have a one-step growth curve in which we can study the infectious cycle of this virus cell combination. And this is a culture where all the cells are infected. Okay? And what happens is we're looking at time versus the number of infectious particles. So we're doing a plaque assay with time. We're simply sampling the culture, the infected culture, and asking how much virus is produced with time. What you see is there's a period where there's little, if any, virus produced. And then all of a sudden, at a certain time, virus production increases substantially, and then it plateaus. And these are very important parts of the infectious cycle that we have to learn. The first is this period during which we don't detect any virus particles or any infectivity. Not virus particles, actually, because particles doesn't imply infectivity. That's the eclipse period. What's happened there is that the virus is attached to the cell and it's put its nucleic acid inside of the cell. And if you then take those cells at those early points into a plaque assay, you won't see any plaques because the nucleic acid itself isn't infectious, not in this assay anyway. So what's happening during this eclipse period, the nucleic acid is getting in the cell, messenger RNAs are being made, proteins are made, and new virions are assembled. As soon as a new infectious particle is assembled, then you will detect it in your assay. So the eclipse period is when the nucleic acid is directing the synthesis of new virus particles. Then you have virus production. This is called the burst, or the yield of the experiment. And here is when the viruses are being made. And eventually, all the cells are dead in the culture, and you have no more increase of infectivity. So that's a one-step growth curve. And in this experiment, what we have done is to infect every cell in the culture so that the infection is synchronous. All right, every cell is infected. We have a synchronous infection. Now on the right, we've done it differently. We have infected very few cells to start. We've made dilutions of our virus such that not every cell is infected. And so what you get is eclipse period initially, you get a burst of virus, and then you get another eclipse period, and then a second burst. They're not as well defined because the things are not happening all at the same time. But you can see you get multiple eclipses and multiple bursts. And the more you dilute the virus you will get more and more rounds of replication. So that's what's going on here. This is a synchronous infection on the left because every cell is infected. You've put enough virus on to infect every cell. On the right, it's an asynchronous infection because you haven't infected every cell. Think about what's going on. On the right, you've infected a certain fraction of the cells. They produce virus, and then that virus goes on to infect whatever uninfected cells were left. So you have multiple rounds, okay? So these are different kinds of growth curves, synchronous one-step or asynchronous multi-step. Now, this is a growth curve with an animal virus. The previous one was a bacteriophage done to establish the concept. What happens with an adenovirus? So these are cells, these are probably HeLa cells infected with adenovirus type 5, which is a DNA-containing virus we'll talk about more next time. And you do the same kind of experiment. You infect all of the cells. You put a lot of virus on so every cell is infected. You have a eclipse period during which you cannot detect infectivity. And then you have virus, the burst of virus production, and then the cells are killed and no more virus is produced. Now, in an animal cell, or at least in this experiment, we have one additional differentiator here, or experimental point. We're actually looking at intracellular versus extracellular virus. And you could have done, we could have done this with the bacteria as well, but we didn't. What you do here is you take, at different time points, you harvest your cells, and you break them open, and you see how much virus is in them. And at the same time, you take a sample of the cell culture medium and determine by a plaque assay how much virus is there. So that is intracellular virus, what's inside the cell, versus extracellular. That's already been released into the medium by the infected cell. So you can see here, if you look at intracellular virus, that starts to appear just after 12 hours in this growth curve. And this number will vary for every different virus cell combination. The extracellular virus, that is virus in the medium, you don't find until after 16 hours. So it takes between 12 to 16 hours for the newly synthesized viruses in the cell to get to be released from the cell. Yeah?
Why did the PFUs decrease during the eclipse period?
Okay, so this happens with some viruses. When you attach the virus at the zero time point, what you've just done is attach viruses to the cell surface. So they are still infectious particles. They haven't entered the cell yet. They haven't released their nucleic acid. The eclipse comes when the nucleic acid comes out of the particle, and it's no longer assayed in a plaque-forming assay. So this difference between intracellular and extracellular viruses defines a second period called the latent period. That is the period in which you can't find any virus outside of the cell. Okay, so the eclipse was virus inside the cell. The latent period is virus outside of the cell. And you can see there is a delay because it takes time from the time when viruses are assembled intracellularly to the time when they get out of a cell. So you can get a lot of information about viral replication from doing these sorts of growth curves. Now, another important point I want to emphasize is that virus multiplication is really different from bacterial growth. In bacterial growth, and I think I mentioned this the other day, you inoculate a broth with a single bacterium and it divides in a binary way. It divides by binary fission. But viruses don't do that. A virus gets in a cell, its nucleic acid then programs the synthesis of new components which assemble to make new virus particles. It's not binary fission. And early virologists were surprised by this. They thought viruses would behave like bacteria. They thought they would simply divide. But they're totally different, and that's an important point to remember. Now, I emphasized before in that one-step growth curve where we have one cycle of virus release, it was a synchronous infection. How do we do that? Well, you have to infect every cell in the culture. How do you do that? So you need to know the virus titer. Can know it in PFU per mil or something else. But mathematically, can we be sure that we've infected all the cells? And the answer is yes, because when you add viruses to cells, the number of viruses that each cell encounters is not simply one to one. So if you each were holding a bucket and I threw 100 tennis balls out into the audience, you wouldn't each get one tennis ball. there would be a distribution. If I just threw all 100 balls at once, some of you would get one ball, some would get two, some would get more, some would get none. And that distribution is described by an equation known as the Poisson distribution. All right, so that determines how many virions each cell gets. When we infect a culture, we talk about a multiplicity of infection. That's the number of infectious particles added per cell. That's simply all that is, not the number of particles each cell receives. We'll talk about how to calculate that in a moment. It's simply how many you add. So if you add 10 to the 7th virions to 10 to the 6th cells, the MOI is 10. It's a very straightforward mathematical calculation. That's MOI, multiplicity of infection, the number of particles added per cell. Now, if you do that, let's figure out how many particles each cell gets. And as I said, infection depends on random collision between viruses or cells. So when you mix cells with virus, just like in the tennis ball experiment, some will get one, some will get two or more. And that's described by the Poisson distribution. So here's the formula. PK is the fraction of cells infected by K virus particles. And M is the multiplicity of infection. So it's rather simple. If you want to know how many uninfected cells there are in a culture, you put zero in and you solve the equation. You can simplify it to P0 equals E to the minus M. And that's relatively straightforward to figure out. Cells receiving one particle is P1M E to the minus M. And cells multiply infected, P greater than 1, is 1 minus E to the minus M times M plus 1. And that's basically subtracting from 1, which is the sum of all the probabilities of K, the probabilities of uninfected and 1. You want to know more than 1, that's multiply infected. So you subtract from 1 uninfected and 1. All right, so that's a pretty straightforward equation. Here's some examples. If you take 1 million cells in a dish and you infect them at an MOI of 10, that means you add 10 to the 7th, PFU, 45 cells are uninfected, according to the Poisson equation. 450 get one particle, and the rest get more than one. So you can see right away, that's how we do a synchronous infection. We do an MOI of 10, end of story. You can make sure that almost every cell is infected. These 45 cells that are uninfected in a 1 million-cell culture are meaningless. If you infected an MOI of 1, 37% of the cells are uninfected. 37% get one particle, and 26 get more than one. So here you have not all the cells infected, obviously, and you can do multiple growth curves. You can do an asynchronous infection. And finally, if you reduce the multiplicity to 0.001, most of the cells are uninfected, but not all of them. Some of them get one particle, 990 cells, and others get more than one. So if you really want to do multiple step growth curves, you do an MOI of 0.001. There are reasons why you would pick different multiplicities depending on what experiment that you're trying to do. And as we go through the course, we'll see examples of that. All right, so let's see if I made myself clear with that one. I think this is our last question. No, one more. And if cells are infected at MOI of 10, in a one-step growth curve or a one-step growth cycle experiment, in the growth curve, you will see what? MOI of 10. Remember what we just said about an MOI of 10, how many cells are infected. All right, most of you seem to have answered number 3, which is correct, a single burst of virus release. At an MOI of 10, remember, most of the cells are infected. MOI of 10, 45 cells are uninfected, 450 receive one particle. So this is essentially every cell infected. You can't do much better than that. And so you get a single step growth curve. One burst of virus release. You don't get multiple bursts. You don't get multiple eclipses. You don't get no burst. Of course, you do get some, unless you didn't add virus, which I've done before. I once did a growth curve which lasted all night. I took time points every 2 hours for 24 hours, and I had forgotten to add virus. It was a long time ago, though. And it's not asynchronous. Asynchronous is only when you have a low MOI and few cells are initially infected and you have multiple rounds. Okay. You can physically measure particles. Now we're moving away from infectivity. There are a bunch of ways you can do this. We'll cover a couple of them just because we're going to be mentioning these assays in the rest of this course, and you should understand them. Hemagglutination, electron microscopy, you can simply look at particles. You can measure enzymes. You can use antibodies to look for antigens or vice versa. And you can measure nucleic acids. A hemagglutination assay is used to measure viruses that can bind to sugars that are present on the surface of red blood cells. Now, viruses don't replicate in them, but they're simply a nice, convenient assay system. So the virus particles will bind to the red blood cell and they will agglutinate. And if you have them in a 96-well format like this, a positive hemagglutination, you see a nice little covering of red blood cells at the bottom of the well. A negative result would be a little button. So if the red blood cells aren't linked to each other in a lattice by the virus particles, they will tumble down to the bottom of the well and make a button. So these samples are negative with the button, and these are positive. And you're making dilutions here of the virus so you can get an endpoint. Let's say the last positive endpoint for this sample is the 512 dilution. So the HA titer would be 512. This is used a lot for influenza virus, for measuring vaccine responses and so forth. You can measure enzymes. Some viruses have in them various enzymes. Retroviruses have a number of enzymes in them. The one that we're going to look at here is called the reverse transcriptase. This is an enzyme that will take the RNA of the virus particle and make a DNA copy of it. So what you can do is, if you have a sample that you think has retroviruses in it, you can add some radioactive precursors to DNA. And if there's RT present, if there's reverse transcriptase present, it will copy the RNA in the virion and make a DNA copy. Or you can add a substrate as well if you wish. Works either way. So here's an example where cells, different kinds of cells were infected with a retrovirus, and then at different days after infection, a little bit of the cell culture medium was taken and mixed with radioactive DNA precursors, incubated, and then it's spotted on a filter. And if there's any DNA product longer than 20 bases, it sticks to the filter. So you can see this particular cell line is infected because it's making reverse transcriptase. And you can see others are not. So it's a way of assaying, again, physical particles by an enzyme that is in the virus particle. We do a lot of serology in virology. We use antibodies extensively. We typically will make antibodies to viral antigens. You can do that in a variety of ways. And then use them to see, for example, in an infected cell where the viral protein is located. Here, an antibody is used to stain a viral protein in the cytoplasm of cells, and a different stain is used to counterstain the nuclei so you can see where you are in the cell. And there are a variety of ways to do this. You can use an indicator. In this case, there's a fluorescent indicator linked to the antibody, or you can use a second antibody with an indicator linked to it. We use a lot of Western blotting in virology, and we're going to be talking about results with that in this course. In this, of course, you separate proteins on a gel. You transfer the proteins to a sheet of some sort, nitrocellulose or other paper, and then you incubate the sheet with antibodies to your proteins. And then you can eventually develop this and see which samples have your viral protein in it. So this is used in the lab, but it's also used to diagnose a number of different virus infections. So again, these are physical methods for detecting viral antigens. Enzyme-linked immunosorbent assays, or ELISAs, are also going to show up a lot in this course. Here, we'd like to measure either the presence of antibody to a virus or viral antigen. So on the left, we're looking for viral antigen. we have a plastic dish, and we put on the plastic dish an antibody that we know is reactive to the viral antigen. And then we use a second indicator antibody that has a fluorescent label, which will bind to the viral protein. So this is kind of a sandwich assay. If viral antigens are present in your infected samples, you'll get fluorescence. You can also look for antibodies against the virus if you put the viral protein on the plastic. And then you say you want to see if someone's infected with a virus. You take some of their serum, make dilutions, and bind it up to the antigen on the plastic. And if antibody is bound there, then you can go in with a second labeled antibody to detect it. Again, we'll be picking these up. We'll be talking about those quite a bit. Fluorescent proteins have revolutionized virology. As you know, they were initially isolated from jellyfish. And these are DNA sequences encoding a protein which fluoresces. And now you can make many different colors. And this is actually a cell culture infected with 7 different colored herpes viruses. So different color in each one. And actually, this was done for a very interesting reason, which we don't have time to go into. But it's used extensively in virology. You can, for example, on the left, put a fluorescent protein gene into a virus and watch the virus infect neurons. So this is a herpes virus infecting a neuron. You can see it in the cell body and all the projections. And you can trace circuits in the CNS by doing this. You can also label single virus particles. You can put green fluorescent protein into the particle. And then you can do single particle experiments. So this is a light microscope assay where we're seeing HIV particles moving inside of a cell. So the GFP amplifies the size of the particle sufficiently so you can see it in a light microscope. Lots of experiments using these as well. The last bit I want to tell you about is detecting nucleic acids, because there's also been a revolution in the last 15 years, starting with polymerase chain reaction, in which you take a sample which you think has viral DNA in it, and you build primers, short DNA primers, to amplify it. And then you go through cycles of denaturing the DNA at high temperature, annealing your primers, and then elongating. And at each step, you get a doubling of the number of products that are made. So you can see you start with one DNA, you go 2, 4, 8, 16, et cetera. You have exponential growth of a short product if it's present. So this depends on an enzyme that can withstand the multiple cycles of heating at high temperatures, 95 centigrade or higher, and elongation, which are at lower temperatures. And they initially came from bacteria isolated from hot springs. A microbiologist named Tom Brock in the 60s was curious about what grew in the hot springs of Yellowstone. And he isolated this enzyme and didn't know what good it was. And then in the 80s, it was used to develop PCR. We also have another great technology called deep high throughput sequencing, where you can take total communities of microorganisms, extract their DNA, and get a sequence for each representative in the community. We talked a little bit about this last time in terms of viral discovery in the environment. And this is used to do metagenomics, sequencing all the viruses in the ocean. You just take a few liters of seawater, extract the DNA, and you can sequence it all. In the old days, we couldn't do this. We could only sequence highly purified preparations. You can identify new viruses. And if someone is sick and you can't figure out what's wrong with them, you could sequence some specimen from them and try and get a clue, and you might find a new virus. This is the old way we used to do sequencing on gels. This is not deep high throughput sequencing. But I used this to sequence the genome of poliovirus in 1980. And it took me 1 year as a postdoc to do that. And today, that's 7,500 nucleotides. It would take you less than a day. You would just send it to a company, and they would sequence it for you. So the increase is amazing. But I'm not really, I don't feel badly about that at all. I learned many other things. We've done a lot of podcasts on TWIV where we talk about discovering new viruses using these technologies. Here a new virus of snakes. It caused a disease in snakes, a very interesting story. Joe DeRisi is a molecular biologist out at UCSF, and someone wrote to him and said, I have a sick snake. She sent a picture of herself with the snake around her neck. Could you figure out what's wrong with him or her? So he got samples and sequenced them and found a new virus of snakes. Very cool story. And here is another story where a new virus was isolated from two patients in Missouri who presented with severe febrile illness. They turned out to have a new tick-borne virus, again discovered by PCR and deep high-throughput sequencing. So this is really an amazing technology that's revolutionizing the field. However, I do want to leave you with one caveat. We're now not looking at infectious virus. We're looking at sequences. Now, I started by telling you about a plaque assay, which tells you about infectivity. But these PCR and sequencing-based methods do not tell you if there's infectious virus present. The only way you can do that is to culture the virus in a cell. So that's a limitation. Nevertheless, many people do studies and assume that virus is present. And this was a New York Times headline of a couple of years ago, "From the Jungle to JFK, Viruses Cross Borders in Monkey Meat." So there are many illegal animal parts that get brought in from Africa and other countries. They come into JFK and they're confiscated. And so labs have taken these parts and done PCR or deep sequencing, and they find viral sequences. But they are not infectious viruses, okay, because you can't actually show that the whole genome is present and the virus is replicating. PCR and deep sequencing are so sensitive that you can pick up very small quantities of DNA. So it's the headline should have been "Viral Nucleic Acids Cross Borders," but of course, it's not sexy enough, so the New York Times is never going to do that. And that brings us to our last question. Which conclusion can be made when using deep sequencing or PCR technologies to detect viruses? So deep sequencing and PCR, what does that detect? Nucleic acids, nothing else, okay? Just nucleic acids. Most of you got number two. It doesn't tell you anything about replication and nothing about antibodies, nothing about enzymes. Virions are infectious. Okay, thank you.